What was strange about what we're talking about in the tsunami in particular before this terrible earthquake was when they flew over the place in Thailand where they had the tsunami, there was no bodies of wild animals. No wild animals died in the tsunami. And last week, we began discussing how wild animals instinctively know when a disaster is approaching. They do know. How they knew that a tsunami was coming and went to the higher ground, whether they be the gorillas or elephants, they knew. Human beings who, you know, are God's chosen ones, didn't know. Gorillas and elephants and other wild animals, they knew. And they were saved while the human beings were killed and washed out into the ocean. Strange. Since, you know, Jesus loves the little children, as I said, maybe that meant little elephants and little gorillas and things like that. And then we talked about Pier 39 in San Francisco, a tourist attraction for over 20 years. And sea lions have congregated on Pier 39 and were a very important tourist attraction in San Francisco. And about 3 weeks ago, something happened. And you'll see the picture on the left is Pier 39 when the sea lions were there. And then everybody woke up one day, and that was it. They were all gone. They left. And it had to leave you thinking, well, what's happening? Now, could what we considered was, could those sea lions have known of the impending earthquake in Haiti? And you say, oh, no, that's too far away. But would distance make a difference? Would not an impending catastrophe vibrate throughout the entire electrical system of nature and possibly cause them to move on for whatever reason? Now, 2 weeks after they left, there was a 6.5 earthquake in the ocean off Northern California. And then, of course, this tremendous earthquake in Haiti. Could all of the animal kingdom know? I mean, you know, I always get a kick out of them, and my head goes in different directions, but sometimes I watch at night. Do you ever watch it? You know, late afternoon or early evening, you see the seagulls flying off in a different direction, and the birds line up or wherever they are, and they're all going off somewhere. And I said, where the heck? It's, you know, to them, we don't even exist. You know, we're moving things down there, and it's a whole different world. They answer to a completely different thing than human beings do. And it would appear that the things that we look down on, the animals seem to have a much higher level of light, of understanding natural things than people do. And then we talked about Oscar the cat. And this is Oscar the cat. Well, Oscar wandered into a nursing home in Rhode Island and then started making rounds. And this is him actually making rounds. He goes from one room to the next. And Oscar knew, or knows, because he's still there, about 3 hours in advance when somebody was going to die. And he would jump into the bed with that person, get close to them, and just stay there until the person died, and then leave. I mean, one time they said that they had two people dying at the same time, and Oscar was running back and forth in one room out the other, but, you know, he received an award for his service, and the administrator up there said, no human being could know things that he knows. Now, wouldn't it seem strange that God or Jesus would allow a cat to be more understanding concerning the nature of death than a person? You could call a priest, you could call a minister, you could call a rabbi, but nobody would be able to comfort or assist the dying person in that transition like a stray cat. Amazing. As we were closing the meeting last Friday, we began to talk about something strange connected to a cat as it applies to a human being. Remember, we talked about that. And this is a little piece written by somebody by the name of Allison Cook. And I wanted you to take a look at it. It's a little difficult, but I thought it would be more effective if I just took the original from the page. A purring cat is not necessarily a happy one. Many species, including cheetahs and some lions, also purr when wounded or anxious. Some researchers speculate that this lovely rumble may serve a function to heal fractures and strengthen bones. In Anna's yet unpublished study from the Fauna Communications Research Institute in Hillsboro, North Carolina, investigators determined that the frequency at which many cats purr, between 27 and 44 hertz for house cats, matches the frequency that seems to help human bones strengthen and grow. If correct, the theory may explain why cats heal so quickly after injury. So we have animals knowing a tsunami is coming. We have animals knowing an earthquake is coming. We have animals knowing death is coming. And we have animals whose sounds heal. All of these things that people have no clue about. No clue. So there appears to be something that's active in animals that's invisible to us, but directly connected to what we call God or nature. So what is it? The thing is, and this might be a little difficult for you, but there is a person inside of an animal. An electronic person. Who is it that is communicating with Oscar, telling Oscar that somebody is going to die in 3 hours? There is some body inside of this head in the form of an electronic person, an intelligence, because he's a cat. And you could put a human being next to him, and neither of them would know. I mean, it's just stuff. I mean, you see sometimes when they get hit by cars or laying out on a highway, but there's something here. There is something of a light, something of an intelligence, something of a higher knowledge that is inside. Now, the Oscar can still just act like a cat because that's the way his brain is made. Can't talk and can't. But yet he knows things that human beings do not know. And the funny thing is, what he knows applies to human beings. There was a story recently about someone in one of these amusement parks, I don't know, these SeaWorld things, I don't know whether it was in this country or another country, I think it was in another country, Italy I think it was, and the person dove and hurt themselves and was at the bottom of this large pool, and this whale of some kind went down, took the person and threw them up out of the water, and you know, they were saved. I mean, so there has to be something in there that says, that person's in trouble, I'll do something. And the same thing with Oscar, something has to say, Mrs. So-and-so is going to die, you better get in there and help her to transition. Something very strange. Something invisible communicates with that cat. You and I can't see it. And you and I do not have the same communication. No human being has the same communication as that cat. And as humans are running around in confusion, Oscar knows exactly what to do, when to do it, and when to stop. They asked the administrator up there, he said, well, I call people all the time to come here and say, your relative is looks like they're going to pass away, and people can fly for thousands of miles and get here and the person's fine. And he says, sometimes I'm wrong. He says, but Oscar is never wrong. Now, if there is a communication, we'll just focus on this cat for the day. If there is a communication telling this animal what's going to happen, it has to be electric. Electrical signals that are coded so that in some cat way he understands what the programming is and what he has to do. There's some kind of intelligent electrical communication directed to Oscar that causes him to know a human being is going to die and that he has to get up and get close to that person's body and stay there until the person died. It doesn't communicate with us. I mean, you know, while Oscar is doing this, millions of people all over the world are going into church and taking communion and getting anointed and all of this, and they know nothing. And Oscar comes out of his litter box and knows everything. So each animal then is not only electrically programmed to do what it should do, but they are open to electrical messages to instruct them concerning what action they should take. A tsunami's coming. Well, nobody gets inside of a sea lion's head saying, there's a tsunami coming. No. Something plugs into the sea lion brain and it tells them in sea lion language, get out of here. In the same way that it tells Oscar what to do with human beings. All this through an electrical program which communicates via photon. And what we would say is that it's instinct. You know? Oh, the sea lion, well, it's instinctive. Oh, the gorillas, oh, that's instinct. What's the instinct? What instinct does this cat have about human beings dying? But what is instinct, anyhow? Let's take a look. Instinct is an inborn pattern of behavior that is characteristic of a species and is often a response to specific environmental stimuli. So that's interesting, isn't it? It's characteristic of a species. So in other words, each species might have a different characteristic, and then when something happens, it triggers this electrical response. The innate capacity of an animal to respond to a given stimulus in a relatively fixed way. Which means, you know, one of the things I could never understand when we got one of our first dogs many years ago, who was about to have many puppies, I pleaded with the doctor, said, you're going to be here, right? When this happens, don't worry, I'll be there. Well, he wasn't. She knew how to do everything. There was no need. I mean, with all due respect, women go to the hospitals, they have to be surrounded by doctors and machines and EKGs and FBIs and everybody's going around and all the stuff is happening. The dog did everything by itself. And we take all of these puppies to the veterinarian and he puts a little tincture of iodine on the umbilical cord place and we bring them home and she, first thing she did, went around and licked off the iodine. Because she knows, see? An inherited tendency of an organism to behave in a certain way, usually in reaction to its environment, and for the purpose of, this is the interesting, fulfilling a specific need. What was Oscar's specific need? To help somebody transition over from life to the other side. Instinct, as opposed to reflex, is usually used of inherited behavior patterns that are more complex or sometimes involve a degree of interaction with learning processes. Now, the interesting words in that particular slide, I think, is the ability to respond to a specific environmental stimuli. In other words, a message is received and inside that being, that animal, that is programmed to respond. And they do. So what would human instinct characteristics be? Well, we have the fight or flight syndrome. If you get into a situation where your life is in danger or something's going to happen, your body will immediately program itself so, you know, that your blood will clot quicker and so forth and so on. That this happens automatically. So that's an instinctive thing. It happens by itself. But that's purely physical. You don't have anything to do with that. But it doesn't seem to touch the way we think. The human still has to make up his or her mind as far as reacting to an environmental stimuli. There's no, you know, we don't listen to an inborn quality. We turn on the radio or the television, and we do what somebody else says to do. The sea lions do not turn on the TV. The sea lion, one sea lion says to the other sea lion, did you see the weather report? Is this really going to happen or what? They don't have to. Oscar doesn't turn on the TV to see if, or go around and ask the doctor. I mean, you know, I got this feeling Mrs. Goldstein's going to die. Do you think, what do you think I should do? No. It doesn't have to do that. You and I have to do that. See? When we don't know what to do, we go to other people who equally do not know what to do. And then we are all sure that we know what to do even though we don't know what to do. You see, it's like if we're in an insane asylum, we don't go to the doctor who would be up here in our mind, the right side. We go downstairs to the other patients in the insane asylum. And the other patients in the insane asylum are writing the news, they're on television, they're in the White House or they're in Congress, and we say, do you think this is, and they tell us. But they're in the insane asylum too. So the insane people tell us, who are also insane, what to do. And we all do it, and the thing is a mess. If the animals did what we do, they would die. They would have stayed down at the beach and wait for the tsunami to come and get washed out. Oscar would have never gotten his reward because the doctor would have said to Oscar, Oscar, I don't think Mrs. Jones is really going to die. I think she's coming along pretty well. So you don't have to bother. Why don't you go out tonight and meet one of your friends? See? But Oscar didn't have to do that. Oscar said, you know, I know what I know. You don't. And so here we have a situation where animals are much higher in this God thing, in this nature thing, than any human being. It's a big difference. I don't know how many times, and Joan can tell you this, I've tried to help little animals in distress. Little animals, you know, you find them. I remember one time it was a baby squirrel. We got instructions what to do. And we made a little thing for it, and it, you know, looked like good. So I figured the next morning, I said, gee, must be thirsty. And I got a little eyedropper with water, and I squeezed the eyedropper and drowned the damn thing, and it died instantly. I know. Well, how do you think I felt? And whether we find ducks or whatever, you know, little birds will take the bird in and nurture it back, and they all die. Because we don't really know. It's just like us, everything else we do. The road to hell is paved with good intentions. There are electrical messages for every living being. Let me tell you the difference between you and Oscar and you and the gorilla and you and the sea lions and the elephants, etc., etc. They have their connections tuned in all the time. You have to turn yours on, and most of us never do. Now, last week, we received the earliest instructions that I've ever been able to confirm, and I think we've done quite a bit of good confirmation about the Emerald Tablets. 26,000 years ago, someone gave us words to speak in a meditative state. They said, you go into a dark room, you surround yourself like in a circle, and you say these words. But what it said was interesting. Let me show you the part from the Emerald Tablet. And this was given by a UFO commander 26,000 years ago. By their names I call them to aid me, free me, and save me from the darkness of night. Antanas, Quirtus, Chaitel, Guyana, Huertel, Zambetta, Ardell. By their names I implore you, free me from the darkness, and so forth and so on. Now, how many times have you said words, stop, nothing. But we don't understand, do we? You must understand, you'll be free from the bondage of the brothers of night, but here's the key. Understand that the names have the power to free you by their vibration. In other words, there are no people named this. Okay? The words don't mean anything. It's the vibration. It's the way the sound interacts with the frequencies of your brain. And that was given 26,000 years ago. Excuse me. I want to take you to a website. I don't know if you'll have time to write this down, but it might be interesting. www.bibliotechadesplayades.net. If you have this on your TV, you're watching this, you might want to put it on pause and just copy that down. It's an interesting site. On this site is a page I wanted to share with you that I believe connects both to the Emerald words, and I've given these to some of you that have requested it, as well as the question of instinct in humans and animals. Let's look. This is called the living internet inside of us. The human DNA is a biological internet and superior in many aspects to the artificial one. In other words, the human internet inside of you is much superior to the internet that you work on the computer. The latest Russian scientific research directly or indirectly explains phenomena such as clairvoyance, intuition, spontaneous and remote acts of healing, self-healing, affirmation techniques, unusual light auras around people, namely spiritual masters, mind's influence on weather patterns, and much more. Last line about the influence on weather patterns is interesting because that's what Buddha said thousands of years ago, that when you have millions and millions of people thinking negative things, it affects the weather patterns and can throw the cosmos into an upheaval of storms. Okay, so let's look what else it says. In addition, there is evidence for a whole new type of medicine in which DNA can be influenced and reprogrammed by words and frequencies without cutting out and replacing single genes. Think back. The Emerald UFO commander said these words will do this for you, and it is the vibrations of those words that will do that for you. And here, this is saying, the Russians said that DNA can be influenced and reprogrammed by words. According to them, that means the Russians, our DNA is not only responsible for the construction of our body, but also serves as data storage and in communication. The Russian linguist found that the genetic code follows the same rules as all our human languages. To this end, they compared the rules of syntax, the way in which words are put together to form phrases, semantics, the study of meaning in language, and the basic rules of grammar. So now what we're talking about here, I gave many of you, I sent these words to via email. Others, I gave them here in a printed form in this room. And I'm trying to say, can we justify saying these words? Is this more, are we going to stand in a more gobbledygook, or is there something scientific attached to this that could say, do it? Because this came from what I believe was a UFO force that landed in the desert 26,000, 30,000 years ago. So we're seeing from this study a connection to the emerald concerning these words and how the words can actually change the internal structure of the human psyche. The Emerald Tablet says that these words will bring great change into our lives, and this study gives power to words to change DNA. That would confirm, wouldn't it, that there is a connection between words, sounds, and the internal human structure. Let's go on. The Russian biophysicist and molecular biologist George Jarvis and his colleagues explored the vibrational behavior of DNA. Read that with me again. Russian physicist explored the vibrational behavior of the DNA. And what did the UFO commander say? You must understand the names have the power to free you by their vibration. There's a connection there. A connection. They, meaning the Russians, managed, for example, to modulate certain frequency patterns onto a laser array and with it influence the DNA frequency and the genetic information. Since the basic structure of DNA alkaline pairs and of language are of the same structure, no DNA decoding is necessary. Read this again. You must understand the names have the power to free you by their vibration. Look at the last line. One can simply use words and sentences of the human language. You see the connection. This is 26,000, 30,000 years ago. This is today. Now, I placed that statement from the Emerald Tablet there in green so you can compare it to the discovery of the scientist. The names, according to the Emerald, have the power because they set up a vibration with you. So if you say the name Antana, Antana sets up a certain frequency vibration in the brain. That vibration would mean that you're not going to shake, but rather there's a change in the modulation to a different frequency. Okay? Don't think of vibration as... No. It's a change in the modulation of a frequency by the internal photonic or atomic electron vibration. What is interesting is that the study shows that to modulate to a certain frequency, you can use words and sentences. So let's try to understand it. The Emerald says certain words can change you by their vibration. The Russians say you can modulate frequency simply by using words or sentences. Now, what does that mean? When you get in your car, you'll notice your radio has two positions, AM and FM. Now, keep in mind, we're talking about modulation as it concerns a frequency. And we have an interest in that because the Emerald Commander said, by saying certain words, you can change your inner self. Okay, so let's go to AM and FM as you have it on your radio. First of all, modulation. What does that word mean? The transmission of a signal by using it to vary a carrier wave. Okay? Now, let's say you have a carrier wave. Okay? You impact the signal onto that carrier wave, and it causes it maybe to go like that. So what you're doing is you're changing the carrier wave from that to that, and that's called modulation. Alright? Now we go to AM. You know what AM radio? You get a lot of static on AM radio and so forth and so on. AM radio is amplitude modulation. That means the signal being superimposed on a radio frequency. So let's see, again, here's the radial frequency coming out like that. Now, AM radial, what it does is they impose a signal right on top of that frequency. That's AM, okay? So we'll put that AM. So that's amplitude modulation. FM is frequency modulation. The signal is a sound wave. Okay, we have a sound wave. That's the signal. And its increasing and decreasing value is reflected in the increasing and decreasing frequency of a radio frequency carrier wave. So in other words, what that's saying is that this sound wave then would have increasing, decreasing changes affected to it by the transmission, which then makes it frequency modulation. So you are changing, you are actually changing the frequency of that carrier wave. Okay, so we're changing the frequency of the carrier wave with FM. With AM, we're simply attaching to it. We're not changing it, we're just attaching to it. We're riding on it. All right? Now, that may appear confusing to a non-scientific mind, but look at it in reference to the words that were given to us by this Emerald UFO commander thousands of years ago, that it would change you. If you listen on the AM radio, it can be scratchy, you can get interference, yeah. You switch over to the FM frequency modulation, it'll be very clear, see? So there's a change. AM is this way, FM is much clearer. You're an electrical being. You are. You're like the car radio. There's a carrier wave. And that carrier wave comes from the universe and it attaches itself to you. That's how come you can move. You can call it God, you can call it spirit, you can call it angels. It's an electrical wave on a particular frequency that's coming into your body so you can be alive. You can't be alive unless that wave comes into you and plays on you in the same way that this wave plays on the carrier for AM, or this change of frequency plays for FM. When that carrier stops entering your body, you're dead. Let me show you how they measure it. You've seen these things. This guy is not doing too well. This guy's doing pretty good. This is getting to the point where probably we better call Oscar. Or Oscar doesn't have to be called. Oscar knows. Because what could happen very soon is that this guy could be like that. It's over. The frequency is no longer being modulated. That frequency line flattens out. The carrier wave is no longer being received by you. You're dead. What the Emerald is talking about is changing that carrier wave by the use of a frequency vibration of special words. So let's say this is you. Yeah, pretty healthy, looking pretty good. Huh? No, no.
Billy, that's just different things with the person. You want to look at the top two.
The top two.
Yeah.
Well, which one? This guy's not too good?
No, it's just a different lead. That guy's pretty good.
All right, well, yeah, whatever. But let's take a look. What the Emerald Commander is saying is that your wave is here and you're doing pretty good as a person. But you still got to call up to find out what you should do. You're not connected. That wave inside of you has to be adjusted. So now, I don't want it going like that. I would rather it go like that. Then you'll be That's the God wave. Oh, geez. You see what I'm saying? There has to be a change. And what he is saying is that by saying those words, the vibration would have the effect of modulating that carrier wave to change the frequency inside of you to put you in touch with the higher. So you have a carrier wave which connects you to the electric universe and keeps you alive. We go back to AM, FM in the next one. Again, we have a carrier wave that is an electrical source that keeps us alive. The words the Emerald Tablet gives us vibrate to change those waves. In other words, those words will modulate the carrier wave and they will change the frequency. They will change the characteristic of a frequency, which says to me that the change will be made in a way that is FM rather than AM. It could be AM, which means those words would cause a vibration that would impose itself on yours. So, in other words, here you are as a normal person, whatever your name is. You have a carrier wave in you, which is natural, but now you say these words, and there's another vibration that starts imposing itself on top of your natural wave. Or it could be FM, which I think would probably be the way. In that case, the words would act as a sound wave, and the sound would cause a change within the frequency modulation inside of you. So instead of going like that, it could go like that or whatever. But I think that sounds to me more reasonable. Okay? And I'm going to, without knowing positively, I'm going to go in that direction to say that it would seem that the words, and the way the Russians describe it, the words would change that frequency within us and connect us into an entirely different realm, which they talked about. Let's go back to the website and see how this works.
I can't really
want my words. Yeah, no, that's good, thanks. One can simply use words and sentences of the human language. Well, we saw that before. And of course, the Emerald says you must understand that the names have the power to free you by their vibration. Now it says, this too was experimentally proven. Now, not here, but look at this one. One can simply use the words and sentences of the human language, excuse me. This too was experimentally proven. Living DNA substance in living tissue will always react to language modulated laser waves and radio waves if the proper frequencies are being used. This finally and scientifically explains why affirmations, autogenous training, hypnosis, and the like can have such a strong effect on humans and their bodies. Look at it is entirely normal and natural for our DNA to react to language. Now, what am I doing this for? I'm doing this so you won't feel like a nincompoop when you go in a room and start saying these words. And in case somebody happens to overhear you, Eva, what are you doing in here? Do you think Mom is okay? I want you to be comfortable with reciting these words, not as some cult, but as a scientific modulation of the incoming cosmic carrier that will allow you to be changed to the higher. You are seeing more insanity set loose on this planet Earth by people who are in control than ever before. And it's not good for you to be associated and to be receiving instruction from them any more than Oscar would or the elephants. DNA will always react to language. Now notice the Russian scientist found that the language can do the modulation. And that's what the UFO commander said. The UFO commander said, if you say these words, the vibration of these words is going to change you and set you free. And you say, well, what the heck is that talking about? Well, look up here. And look at it means that the words have the ability, through the vibration of the photons in the quantum realm, to change the carrier wave from that which is human on the lower side to that which is on the higher side. Let's go back. We got this here again. Is this the new one you just put up?
I just put it up.
Okay. All right. One can simply use words and sentences of the human language. Esoteric. Esoteric means inside. And spiritual teachers have known for ages that our body is programmable by language, words, and thought. This has now been scientifically proven and explained. Of course, the frequency has to be correct. Now you stop, you're stumped there, right? Oh, Jesus, where am I going to get the frequency? And this is why not everybody is equally successful or can do it with always the same strength. The individual person, now take this one carefully, the individual person must work on the inner processes and maturity in order to establish a conscious communication with the DNA. In other words, you got to work at it. That thing that people really don't have time for is what can change everything for you, especially as we approach 2012 meditation. Oh, yeah. You don't tell me. I know. You come in here on Tuesday night, two or three people. The important line is that the frequency has to be correct. Well, you don't know what frequency it's on. Names have the power, but it has to be the correct frequency. Okay, let's go back. The Russian scientists found that our DNA can cause... Now, I want you to set up straight a little bit because it gets good here. No, I'm only teasing you. I'm just saying, yeah, gotta use your head a little bit. Our DNA can cause different patterns in the vacuum. Remember what Nassim Haramein said? The vacuum is the invisible place where nothing is except the 64 tetrahedron. Thus producing magnetized wormholes. Our DNA can cause magnetized wormholes. This is sensational. You ready for this? These are tunnel connections between entirely different areas in the universe through which information can be transmitted outside of space and time. Your DNA can cause magnetized wormholes, yours, that can allow tunnel connections to different areas in the universe outside of space and time. An example from nature. This is great. When a queen ant is separated from her colony, building still continues according to plan. If the queen is killed, all work in the colony stops. No ant knows what to do. Apparently, the queen sends the building plans from far away. She can be as far away as she wants, as long as she is alive. In man, hypercommunication is encountered when one suddenly gains access to information that is outside of one's knowledge base. Such hypercommunication is then experienced as inspiration or intuition. But what is it really? It's part of this DNA wormhole where communication is being carried out between some intelligence somewhere in the universe and you. You know what you're looking at when you think of that? That's what Albert Einstein called spooky action at a distance. And that's what called Albert Einstein to quit science. I'm out of here. Give me a drink. I can't deal with it. Vibrating electrons or atoms communicate with each other regardless how far apart. If you have a vibrating atom here, that's in right here, Forked River. You have another one here, which is in the southern part of Pluto. If you make this one go down, this one will go up. And they're not connected. You know, this isn't hocus pocus or spooky. This is a scientific fact. Tunnel connections, I love that. Different areas in the universe, you're trying to figure out, how can my prayers get through? You didn't know anything, you had to go through the tunnel. Oh, why? You're trying to go to church? No, you got to go through the tunnel. This is the power that can be received through the words given by the Emerald Tablet. Look, the Queen Ant gives instructions through frequency modulation as long as she is alive. How can this be? How can this possibly be? The Queen Ant is over here, maybe a mile away, and all the little ants are over here taking this stuff running back and forth. You know, where the hell is she? She never shows up. She's doing. All of a sudden, she dies, and they stop. Well, what happened? I don't know. What are we supposed to do? I don't know. I'm going upstairs. I'm getting out of here. Let me introduce you to a physicist by the name of Nick Herbert. He's a bit of a wild-looking guy, but you're going to have to decide if you want to trust him or not. There's Nick. Okay. Go ahead. Nick Herbert, Ohio State University, another one, Huntsville, Alabama, developed a method for increasing energy resolution of gamma ray scintillation detectors. Stanford University, Los Trancos Woods, built semiconductor particle detectors. Monmouth, Illinois, assistant professor of physics. Monmouth College, Memorex, Santa Clara. Senior physicist, developed new magnetic materials. Ohio State University, BSE Engineering Physics, summa cum laude. Stanford University, PhD physics major, math minor. Would you accept him as credible? If you don't, you call him up and tell him he's not credible. And Nick looks a little wild. I don't know if you want to do that. Okay, Nick. How is it possible for the queen to instruct the colony of ants, even though they're far apart? Physics concerns itself only with outer experiences, not inner. And the primary physics story about appearances is quantum theory, which describes without error the complete range of quantum facts. A particular class of quantum facts concerns the EPR experiment. I want you to hold that in your head. Can you think of that? EPR. Think of that? Can you repeat that?
EPR.
Oh, they are. They've learned a lot. Named after Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen, in which two quantum particles, A and B, which were once together, fly apart and are measured at two distant locations. So let's call A the queen ant and B the ant colony. Okay? Yes. All right. Yes. In the quantum theory, observer, now I put this in A, the queen, choice of what kind of measurement to make on particle A instantly changes the state description of B, which is the colony. A general feature of quantum theory called quantum phase entanglement. When the particles separate, the phases of particle A, the queen, remain entangled with the phases of particle B, the colony. Any action on A, the queen, such as an observation, changes not only the queen, but the phases of the colony as well. Okay? So they're totally in touch with one another, even though they can't see one another. And this As we get a little higher, you're going to want to think of this and people you have been in touch with or you are separated from. Keep that term EPR, because I'm going to show you proof. Now, let's go to the next one. This action of observer A, the queen, on the distant particle of a colony does not diminish with distance. Doesn't make any difference how far it is. It cannot be shielded, and it travels faster than light. This, in theory, distant influence is unmediated, unmitigated, and immediate. It's like that. This, in theory, quantum connection between two particles, once together, now apart, is a lot like voodoo. I am going to stick a pin in the doll, and Paul is going to jump out of his seat. That's what it means. No known force connects particle A, the queen, and the bee colony. Just the fact of their once being together suffices to mingle their phases. Who were you once together with that may not be around anymore? And could that person be having an effect on you? And could you be having an effect on that person? This is interesting. The voodoo effect in theory. But then along came John Stuart Bell. And John Stuart Bell came from Ireland. And he set the science world on its ear by proving this wasn't a theory. John Stuart Bell wrote what is called Bell's Theorem. Unfortunately, he has since died. But here he is. And here is what he accomplished. Irish physicist John Stuart Bell considered the EPR system and showed with a devilishly clever proof that all conceivable models of reality must incorporate this instant connection. It has to. You are instantly connected with others. They are instantly connected with you. And you do things based on their vibrations, and they do things based on yours as the ant and the queens interact. What Bell showed is that despite the fact that relativity prohibits instantaneous connections, despite the fact that no such connections have ever been observed, either in EPR or any other, despite the fact that quantum theory predicts no observable connection, despite all of these considerations from fact and theory, the reality of EPR particles is such that their initial contact must create an instantaneous voodoo-style link between them. And here again, John Stuart Bell used that same word, the voodoo style connection, every time that we have some kind of an organizational contact with whomever it may be, no matter how far away they may be, there is an effect on us and an effect from us to them. John Stuart Bell, and you and I would run out of here with absolutely, what the hell is he talking? Would never. He proved this without a doubt that this instantaneous voodoo style link exists between all of these things. He proved it. And I would show you Nick Herbert's summation of John Stuart Bell's theory. Bell's theorem, reality must be non-local. In other words, you know what that means? Okay, look, let's do local reality. Eva's sitting in that chair. Everybody see her? She's up here. Yeah. This, everybody see this? Now, I want you to reach and touch the person sitting in the chair directly behind you. And you're not going to see anybody there. But there's somebody there. That's non-locality. And the reason that you're here is because someone else vibrational effect on you, which is connected to you, that's non-locality. In other words, what we see here is here. What we don't see here but is affecting us is non-locality. For several reasons. One, it is a mathematical proof, not a conjecture or speculation. Two, it is a proof about reality, not appearances. How often does one find such a window into the nature of reality? You don't see anybody standing here, even though there is somebody standing here. See? You say, well, wait a minute. That's appearances. There's nobody there, but the reality is there is. You see, we don't get a chance to talk to these people. They talk amongst themselves, you know. Because if they go on television, everybody, oh, this guy's nuts. Here. No, this guy's nuts. I saw Jay Leno doesn't believe this stuff. So what instantaneous effects are taking place from someone else who is no longer near you? I don't think any. Think about it sometimes when you're alone, maybe. Let your mind go in that direction when you repeat the words. What's going to happen when you repeat the words and maybe work on it for a while? What's going to happen? and your waves start changing and you start seeing or hearing or whatever. What instantaneous effects take place on us when we, as ourselves, join with A, the emerald force, through the incantations they have given us? Well, we saw this before. Remember? The wormholes, tunnel connections between different areas in the universe, transmitted outside of space and time. Isn't that what the UFO commander said? Yes, he did. Things that are not here, no appearance, can affect you and what you do and what you think. That's what everybody goes to church for. That's what you've been hoping for. To evoke a response from the emerald beyond space and time. And when it happens, you'll be inspired. No, you won't. You've had your frequency modulated. What Oscar the cat has, what the sea lions have, what the gorillas have, what the elephants have, what the ants have, you finally can have. You don't have it, but you can. In man, In man, hypercommunication is encountered when you gain access to information that wasn't there before. It's inspiration. In earlier times, humanity had been just like the animals. You read about it in the Bible. They knew. Connected to this group consciousness, to develop and experience individuality, we humans had to forget that. Oh, you know, it happens all the time. You got little kids. The little kid will say, I was talking to a little man in my room. All right, Rodney, you know, we're going to get you out to play soccer. You don't want to be doing that, you know. What's wrong with that kid, Mabel? He's got to get out of the house. No, he really is talking to somebody, but we don't allow that. The little kid may spin. How many times? Oh, stop that spinning. You're going to get dizzy. You're going to make me throw up. I can't stand it. Why is he spinning? Just like the Sufi Muslim, the whirling dervish, because he's connecting to the universe, and we break him of that terrible habit. We now know that just as on the internet, our DNA can feed its proper data into the network, can call up data from the network, and can establish contact with other participants in the network. You go on the internet, you hit a little plastic thing, and you're talking to somebody in Africa, or Ireland, or California, just by touching a little plastic thing, and they talk back. That's the internet. But what they're trying to tell you is you have an internet here, and the entire universe is an internet, and everybody is on the internet. And they don't even have to have a laptop, because they're on the internet. Your data can be fed into the network, which is consciousness, can call up data from the network, which is incoming consciousness, and establish contacts with other participants in this cosmic, invisible, what you want to call spiritual network. They had it a long time ago. Do you ever read about the pineal gland of the brain? Sometimes go in and look up pineal gland of the brain. You know what it says? It's a vestige. It once was bigger, but for lack of use, it has petrified or shrunk up. But now, by understanding quantum, we're realizing we can feed into the cosmic network and we can call up information from that network with other participants regardless of where in the universe they may be. Remote healing, telepathy, remote sensing about the state of relatives, etc., can thus be explained because you're touching them in the internet network of the cosmos. Some animals know from afar when their owners plan to return. That can be freshly interpreted, explained via the concepts of group consciousness. Researchers think that if humans with full individuality would regain group consciousness, they would have a godlike power to create, alter, and shape things on the earth. For if it were to use its mental power as a unified civilization, it would have control of the energies of its home planet as a natural consequence, and that includes all natural catastrophes. In other words, you could be just like a damn elephant and get out of the way when something's coming. Knowing in advance, you could know. Down that way. You regain the cosmic power that was taken from you. And remember, the Emerald UFO commander said it would come to you by following the instructions. Every one of us has the spiritual powers to affect this repair of genes ourselves. But this is similar to a person who, due to an accident, has to spend 2 years in a wheelchair. Should he get healthy again, he still has to learn slowly and steadily how to walk properly, as if he had never known how to walk before. And this is just what happens with our spiritual powers. Very slowly it starts to sink in that we would have the power to affect a lot in many areas of life. But for many centuries, if not millennia, we have taken sitting in a kind of a spiritual wheelchair and have to learn now how to use these powers all over again. This is what is being given to you. And you yourself have full authority to either accept it or reject it. And I will conclude with this from the Emerald UFO Commander. Utanas, Quertus, Chaitil, and Goyada, Huertil, Semveta, Ardell. You must understand that the names have the power to free you by their vibration. Now to you I give my magic. Take it and dwell on the pathway of light. Light unto you, life unto you. Sun, may you be on the cycle above. Thank you for being with us, and we'll see you again soon. Bye-bye.
Take the leaves, you're a nun. It will look really good.
Right now?
Yes, okay, please.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Here's Bill.
Good for you. Yay! Good job.
And he wants 12 cents for that. He got nothing. What for that? He's going to heaven because he did that. That's all they get paid. Well, you have to give me a second to get this straightened out. I wasn't quite ready, and Jeremy. What did he say? Okay, I'll be with you in 1 second. And, all right. Okay, welcome everybody to Hidden Meanings. And let's go to the board real quick, and I'll show you where we're at. Hidden Meanings Conference Center, Village Green Shopping Center, Route 9, Fork River. And our address, P.O. Box 569. The email, be donna91078200@yahoo.com. We're here Friday at 7 to have meditation with music, Tuesday at 7. And right now, we have, Joan, right? right now, our website, www.hiddenmeanings.com, we have 1,477,166 visitors, which means we did over 2,000 last week, so that was very good. And our address, mailing address, is Hidden Meanings, P.O. Box 569, Forked River, New Jersey, 08731. Let me make a little, before we get into this, let me make a little announcement here. Kathy, you want to put that on pause for a minute? You know, where the pause is, we'll just pause that for... Okay, once again, Hidden Meanings, Post Office Box 569, Forked River, New Jersey. I want to show you a picture of the tsunami that hit Thailand in 2004. You can see it washing over the cars. I think you really get the effect of it when you look up here and see the size of that wave, and then just think of it all the way down and what's going to happen to this bunch. Yeah. Thousands of people died there, and there was much destruction. And the interesting thing, because you're studying for marine biology, is it?
Yes.
Just think about this for a while. But when, after all of thousands of people had been killed, planes flying over the scene noticed something strange. Of all the death and destruction below, there were no bodies of wild animals. No wild animals died in that tsunami. They left. They somehow were told something is going to happen, and in their gorilla way and in their elephant way, they said, it's time to get out of here. They knew something that people didn't know. So they went up into the mountains, and as they were watching, the human beings were washed out to sea or whatever. So with all our technological, with all our scientific, with all our advanced methods of predicting weather, we did not know what elephants and gorillas knew. Something very bad was going to happen from the ocean, and they moved into the mountains to be safe. Human beings didn't know anything about it, and they died. God didn't tell people what was going to happen. God told the gorillas and the elephants. It's called instinct. It's something that we have given away in order to be part of the mob. And instinct comes from the right side of the brain, what we call the spirit side, the God side, the nature side, the higher photon side. And wild animals are plugged into that all the time. We have to go there. And the Bible and all of the ancient books are filled with instructions. Hey, you better get inside of yourself, and you better start activating that electrical circuitry on the right side. They have it, see? And the reason I bring this up is because it has happened again. So far, on a smaller scale, if indeed the activity is over, but we'll see. Pier 39 is a very famous pier in San Francisco. For over 20 years, sea lions have congregated on Pier 39, and they have been a very important tourist attraction. This is Pier 39 about 3 weeks ago. Here they are, the whole gang, hanging out, having a good time, no problem. This became such a tourist attraction that some of these sea lions got so tame they'd even pose for pictures with the tourists. And when you get a, when you get this next picture, take a look at the sea lion on the right. He said, "Look at this guy." You see? So I mean, you know, it's just a normal thing. Hey, come on, pose for a picture. So once again, let's take a look at Pier 39 about 3 weeks ago. Let's take a picture of Pier 39 1 week ago. They left. The gorillas and the elephants left, and there was a disaster. The sea lions left San Francisco. Once again, the comparison, John. That's what it looked like before. That's what it looks like now. Now, of course, there's, you know, people that don't get into nature saying, well, you know, they're probably looking for something to eat. They'll be back. And consider, could those sea lions have known of the impending earthquake in Haiti? About last week, about a week after they left, there was a 6.5 earthquake in the ocean off of Northern California. But I mean, could they? And you say, well, Haiti is so far away from California. No, not. We're talking about electrical energy of the earth. What do these creatures know? Would it make a difference how far away they were? Would not an impending catastrophe throughout the entire electrical system of nature cause them to move for whatever reason? You know, I've always thought from a religious standpoint concerning God. You know, I was always told, God loves you. He really loves you. God wants to care for you. God's reaching out for you. God looks out for everybody. And then I thought, but why would he tell gorillas and not me? I find that very curious. God tells gorillas and elephants and sea lions, but he doesn't tell us, but he loves us. Take the next one, Joe. It says, Jesus loves the little children. Did you ever hear the song, Jesus loves the little children? But you know what happened? The little children got washed out into the ocean. And the little gorillas and the little elephants were safe. So does that mean maybe that Jesus loves the little gorillas and the little elephants more? I don't know. If he loved the little children as much as he loved the little animals, wouldn't he have allowed the people to have the same information so that they could get out of the tsunami? Or are we missing something? Maybe instead of listening to preachers and weather forecasters who are trying to figure nature out, we should be listening to those who already have it figured out. Remember Oscar the cat at the nursing home? He's still up there. Oscar the cat. A stray cat comes in to a nursing home in Rhode Island. There's Oscar. And then he starts making rounds from room to room. And you know what Oscar did? Every time somebody was about to die, Oscar would jump into the bed of the person who was about to die 3 hours before they died, and then escort them over. He received an award for his service. He's still up there doing it. And they said to the director of nursing or whatever, nursing homes in Rhode Island, doesn't it make you feel a little foolish that an alley cat? And the guy said, well, stop. He says, I have to call people from all over the world to come and say, it looks like so-and-so is going to pass away. And they fly in, and then sometimes I'm wrong. He says, but Oscar is never wrong. Now, wouldn't it seem a little bit strange to you that Jesus would allow a cat to be more understanding concerning the death of a person than a preacher or a priest or a minister or a rabbi. No, the heck with those guys. The cat knows. You can call a priest, a rabbi. None of them would be able to assist the dying person. They'd take out a book and they'd read it and they'd sprinkle water on the walls and all of this kind of stuff. That cat snuggled up to the person, and the vibrations, obviously, just, he guided the person right to where they're going. Oscar would not leave the room until the person had left, had passed on. So what do? Do we honor these who know, these who are part of God? Do we honor them? Do we respect them? Do we listen to them? Do we try to understand their close connection to God? The former governor of Alaska, Sarah Palin, who claims to be a born-again Christian, gets into helicopters and shoots defenseless wolves from the sky. If this is how one who is trying to get close to God should treat a living being, that is very... She's all over the place. The animals that we eat are literally tortured to death by factory farms across the world. The Indians, the American Indians, revered and honored an animal who would provide them food. They honored an animal like a buffalo as God, because you're giving so we can live. And now the Indians exist with us in a civilized country who... people allow their animals who are going to allow them to live to be tortured to death. The Michael Vicks of the world, who use animals in hideous death battles for profit and entertainment. Those who will mistreat pets in terrible ways, leaving them the cold and the die or the starvation. And yet, we don't know. We just don't know. What better way is there to see how people really feel about God and really feel about God's creation than to see how they treat these living beings who are so closely connected to God, the animals? You can go to church, I could care less. You can take communion, nothing. You can give your confessions, you can sing your songs, you can read your Bibles, and then these same people will go out and neglect or brutalize God's creatures who are actually created closer in God's image through natural instinct than are human beings. And the neglect and mistreatment of animals is the most clear demonstration of what people really think of God. In many cases, it comes from people. They'll spend endless hours in reading the Bible or taking up space in church and singing, "Oh God, come down and sit on my lap," and all this crap. And they'll never, ever, ever turn and extend a hand, not only to the cat, not only to the gorilla, but they won't extend a hand to anybody. I mean, you've got these bizarre people on television, this guy Rush Limbaugh, saying that the people in Haiti, they got enough. This is all an Obama plot for black people. That's what he said. Hey, we pay income tax. That's enough for those people. Unbelievable. Absolutely unbelievable. And then, what are we to think? Jesus loves the little children, and the children are killed in the tsunami, but the little animal children are made safe and secure. Does Jesus love the animals more? No, but we are supposed to teach the children how to find that magic inside of us. And we don't. We say, no, you got to listen to him, you got to listen to the pastor, you got to read the book and all this garbage. Never saying, you got to find it inside. Like, you have inside what he has inside, only he doesn't have to find it. He's got it. So we're told that we sing and God loves us and looks over and protects us. But humans are killed by the thousands. As the gorillas and the elephants wandered up to the high country when they received the signal from God. You know what's amazing to me? Does this mean God is a gorilla? Would that be wild? What are you going to do then? What is the pastor going to do when he gets up to the gate? There's a big thing eating a banana. Said, you ain't looking for God, you found him, pal. Oh, boy. Maybe the angels are elephants. The trumpet sound. Hey, I don't know. So we have the prophecy concerning 2012, and we have upheavals on the earth. We have changes on the earth. And of course, we're transfixed on Haiti. I'm not saying that Haiti's part of 2012. Though it could be, and it certainly should be something we connect, but you know what it does? You know what it does more than anything, and it should do for the mass mind? It should give us insight into the lunacy that is religion. The one aspect of our civilization that has kept us in a perpetual dark age by not allowing us to understand ourselves, not allowing us to understand our lives, our place on the earth, because of superstitious drivel that has fried our minds. These people are like zombies walking in and out of these churches. They literally check their brains at the door and accept whatever they're taught. We have a statement from the Reverend Pat Robertson, who has a following of millions. And this is why what he said was the cause of the earthquake striking Haiti. Read this with me. Something happened a long time ago in Haiti, and people might not want to talk about it. They were under the heel of the French. They got together and swore a pact to the devil. They said, we will serve you if you will get us free from the French. True story. And so the devil said, okay, it's a deal. They kicked the French out. The Haitians revolted and got themselves free. And ever since, they've been cursed by one thing after the other. He is saying that the reason they had this thing happen was because some anonymous people made a pact with the devil. And the devil said, okay, it's a deal. Now, this guy's a billionaire. He's a billionaire, and he's got millions of people following him. And not only is he a billionaire, not only is he a born-again Christian, he's a lunatic. It is an evil lunacy concocted by someone who has built people out of billions of dollars over many years of nonsense. An evil lunacy from someone who is an extreme right-wing corporate billionaire. This is the same guy who believes that 9/11 was caused by gays and the Civil Liberties Union. He sat on television with Jerry Falwell, and the money kept pouring in. And this statement, just think of it, with this guy, that some unknown people, years and years ago, made a deal with the devil. And so then, because some unknown people years and years ago made a deal with the devil, God is blessing and allowing a slaughter of hundreds of thousands of innocent men, women, and children. That is as deeply sick as one can get. And if that is what Christianity is, then it should disappear. Between one group raping little children and this nut, and people go in and sit and listen to this stuff. This guy has millions of followers who has sat on every word. And our world has been set back thousands of years by listening to people like that who put trash into the heads of people, regardless of what religion they follow. There's a website called Crooks and Liars, and I recommend you go on it. It's about politicians and things like this. But they outlined what really happened in the situation that Robertson refers to. Of course, I mean, we're all, I think, mature enough to know that nobody made a pact with the devil, and the devil wasn't saying, okay, I'm going to make earthquakes to blow this place to pieces, and God says, nothing I can do. How am I? Okay, let's take a look. Haiti was forced to pay France for its freedom. That was the deal. France said, you give us the money, we'll get out of here. When they couldn't afford the ransom, France and other countries, including the United States, offered high interest loans. By 1900, 80% of Haiti's annual budget went to pay off its reparation debt. They didn't make the last payment until 1947. 10 years later, dictator Francois Duvalier took over the country and promptly bankrupted, taking out more high-interest loans to pay for his corrupt lifestyle. The Duvalier family, with the blind-eye financial assistance of Western countries, killed tens of thousands of Haitians until the Haitian people overthrew them in 1986. Today, Haiti is still paying off the debt of an oppressive dictator that no one would help them get rid of for 30 years. The rest of the world refuses to forgive this debt, so in a way, Robertson is right. Haiti is caught in a deal with the devil, and the devil is us. And what do you think, what's going to happen now? Everybody down there, watch. You think the big bankers aren't down there? Oh, this would be a great place. We'll just... we'll fix this place. And they had a president that was elected by the Haitians called Aristide. But the United States figured, he's leaning to the left. He's a communist. He's going to be like Fidel Castro. We got to get rid of him. And they did. They did. They got rid of him. They got rid of the guy the people down there wanted. Because after all, he might turn Haiti into another Cuba. No such luck. So there's the truth. The devil are those who have exploited Haiti, not some hocus-pocus devil of religious beliefs, but the real devil being those countries who exploit the poor and bleed them for every dime they have, just like religion does. There is no excuse for an earthquake to cause such destruction. The reason the earthquake caused such destruction is because this is the most poverty-driven place in the world, and there is no reason that the rest of the world should have allowed that poverty to exist. The United States was involved in assisting them overthrow the last president. So the energy seems to generate a stronger and stronger response from nature as we rumble on closer to the finalization of December 21st, 2012. I'll tell you something right now, and you sit here and you can feel it. You are living in a very violent planet. Not violence from nature as much as violence from greedy people who run it and exploit the poor, the sick, and the underprivileged. And I can't even, when I watch them on this healthcare thing and I think of, you know, people, young people and old people and trying to come up with $1,000 a month to pay some insurance company who's going to deny them everything. I mean, it's bizarre that it's allowed. This is the only country in the world that exists in anymore. So where can you go to escape these billionaire lunatics? Tom Hartman, who I listen to a lot on television, he's got a word he calls them. He doesn't call them gangsters. He calls them banksters. I mean, you know, I don't know if you understand what happened, but the taxpayers of this country gave hundreds of billions of dollars to these banks, and they're taking your money and giving billion-dollar bonuses with it. And they'll get in front of Congress. Well, you know, these people worked hard. They worked hard. How could they work hard? They practically destroyed the whole damn thing. Sure, they have a right to get a billion-dollar bonus, but not with your money, not with my money. Wait till they pay it off. Then they can go do what they want. But the answer to where you can escape them is within yourself. There's no other place to go. Because the solution to their assault against humanity can only come from nature itself in bringing them down. And what has been said by NASA may be on the drawing board. I put up a video on our site from Fox News, of all people, that says what I've shown you before, that between now and 2012 is the distinct possibility of gamma explosions coming this way. That would probably disable the computer systems worldwide, which would mean, we'd all have to gather at Ethel's house and cook some beans and wait to, yeah. My next line is not a pleasant thing to contemplate. I didn't mean that. But the idea of, no hospitals, no. But the warnings about neglecting the poor, exploiting people, neglecting the sick go way over the heads of these bankers or banksters. All these things have come down from the ancient times. But the need for profit has said no. So we'll see. You can sense it's going on. You know how violent, you know how bad it is out there. You know how these corporations are just bilking every dime you got. You can sense what's happening. And so it's time to return to the Emerald Tablet for part 6. This is part 6 of the Emerald Tablet, and I want you to listen to it closely because it's going to get somewhere. It's going to be very interesting for you. And I'm going to show you why something which is going to sound very bizarre to you may be a lifesaver and a mind saver for each one of you. And I'll show you, as I usually do, by connecting it to science. This is from the commander of the UFO fleet that landed pre-Egypt. Long ago, in the days of the first man, warfare began between darkness and light. Man, then as now, were filled with both darkness and light, and while in some darkness held sway, in others light filled the soul. Long ages ago, the sons of the morning descending found the world filled with night. There in that past began the struggle between darkness and light. Brothers of darkness through the ages antagonized the children of men. They walked in secret and hidden, found yet not found by the children of men. When we see the poverty which exists around the world and the neglect of the sick, and even in this country, when you see the assault against nature, when you see the assault against animals for the sake of profit, you have to think to yourself that this planet is indeed controlled by the brothers of darkness. Joan. Silently, secretly, they use their power, enslaving and binding the soul of men. Unseen they come and unseen they go. Man in his ignorance calls them from below. Dark is the way of the dark brothers. Traveling over the earth, they walk through men's dreams into man's mind space, reach the dark brothers. That's a great line. Into man's mind space reach the dark brothers. Listen to my warning. Free yourself from the bondage of night. Don't surrender your soul to the brothers of darkness. Keep your face ever turned towards the light. There is an excellent description of how masses of people are led by those who get into their minds by offering them one thing when they really mean something else. Let me show you an example how the Dark Brothers actually participate in deceiving the mass mind. In the case of global warming, the polls show that in this country, people are beginning to think that global warming is really not that important. In the beginning of the year, 70% thought it was important, and now 57% think it's important. You know what's changed their mind? Television, advertising, people that come on who are getting paid to cast doubt on global warming. And I'll tell you who's underwritten. These ads and all this stuff are underwritten by the Chamber of Commerce, the United States Chamber of Commerce, the Wall Street Journal, and the big oil companies. And they keep pounding. Oh, we're going to have so-and-so on. Yeah, no, I don't think global warming is that big. This guy's getting paid to say that, because if we start attacking global warming, it's going to cut into their profits. You see? And so people sit there watching television and say, I don't believe in this global warming. How come? Well, I saw a guy last night on television, and he had a lot of good facts. Now, he didn't have facts. He was paid to say that. This is billions of dollars being spent by oil companies and so forth in order to deceive people into thinking, oh, you know, it's a big job, so that there are no rules that come out against the oil companies and so forth that might impact on their bottom line. Anything that suggests that global warming is real is a threat to the profit line that these companies represent. So they put this advertising out. And they do it because the facts are on their side that cutting back on industrial pollution will have a negative effect on their profits. That's what it means when it says the dark brothers reach into man's mind space. They reach right into you. And as you're watching television, the guy on television looks like, hey, he knows what he's talking about. Hey, you know, he's got a lot of facts that he's coming. But nobody tells you that he's getting paid by, the Wall Street Journal or these oil companies. And that's what it means. The dark brothers reach into our mind space and confuse us. Okay. Understand this. Always beside you walk the children of light. Sons are they and lords of the morning, children of light to shine among men. Like men are they, and yet unlike. I'll explain it. The sun is the symbol of the light that shines at the end of your road. Now to you I give the secret to meet the dark power, to meet and conquer the fear from the night. And only by knowing can you conquer, only by knowing can you have light. The ability to flow with that light, which is being talked to by the commander of this UFO fleet, is through meditation. And the reason you're even sitting here is because of meditation. It's because of a change inside of you. It's the meditation that opens you to the right side. It's the meditation that gives you the light. Now, what is the secret that's going to be shared with you? And it's going to be difficult for you at first, but I don't want you to laugh about it. I don't want you to laugh it off. I want you to take it very, very seriously. And the reason that I even am telling you about it is because I have spent the time developing a background information from scientific sources. And I feel, in as much as this came from knowledge 30,000 years ago, before there were even any intelligence on the planet by this UFO stuff. So if this may be difficult for you to remember, but next week I'll bring it in writing. But this is the first set of instructions found in the Emerald Six. First, find a place bound by darkness. You can come here, you can go into your room, turn the light off. Place a circle around you. You don't have to print anything, but just get yourself in the middle of it. Stand erect in the midst of the circle. Use this formula and you shall be free. Raise your hands to the dark space above you. Close your eyes, draw in the light. Call to the light through the space-time using these words, and you shall be free. Fill my body with the spirit of light. Come from the flower that shines through the darkness. Come from the halls where the seven lords rule. Basically, the instruction is to go into a dark room, and which is the same type of meditation condition we set up here. And I might add, I am not against using this in our meditation on Tuesday evening, since its origin appears to be from that UFO fleet. Now, we get into the pronunciation of names, which can be difficult. And these names should be memorized so as to be able to say them in darkness. That's why next week I'll give it to you in writing. All right? By their names I call them to aid me, free me, and save me from the darkness of night. Utanas, Quirtus, Chaital, Ingoyana, Huertel, Zimveta, Ardal. By their names I implore you, free me from the darkness and fill me with light. You must understand that when you have done this, you shall be free from bondage of the brothers of night. Now, this last line is the most important. Otherwise, this is more gobbledygook of names that don't mean anything. What the hell am I talking about? The last line I want you to read. You must understand that the names have the power to free you by their vibration. The names mean nothing. These are not people or gods. What is being presented to you by this UFO commander is that the names have a vibration that will change you for the better. That's an explanation, and it's extremely important. But if we're to attach any credibility to it, we have to look. The names don't mean anything, but the sound causes a change within the electrical brain by vibration. The sound vibration is the secret. So, Untanis, Quirtus, Chaitel, Guyana, Huertel, Samveda, Ardal are sounds that vibrate in such a way to open channels on the right side, which can overcome lower channels on the left side. And the UFO commander completes Tablet 6 in this way. Yuntanis, Quirtus, Chaitel, and Guyana, Huertel, Samveda, Ardal, you must understand that the names have the power to free you by their vibration. Use them as needed. And that's very important because it's not a permanency. It's when the situation arises for yourself and your brother so that he may come forth from the night. You are your brother's helper. Let him not lie in the bondage of night. Now unto you I give my magic. Take it and dwell on the pathway of light. Light unto you, life unto you. Sun, may you be on the cycle above. This comes from the one purported to be the commander of the UFO fleet at the land of Kim. So you can use this magic for yourself or for others. Now let's see if we can come up with some credible scientific evidence here. Because otherwise, you've heard all this kind of stuff before. Say this, say that, repeat this, nothing. Nothing happens. Okay, so what I would have to do then is somehow come up with credible scientific documentation to support the Emerald instructions concerning the names that will produce vibrations to raise your consciousness in your brain. There's a book called Brainwave Vibrations, written by a guy named Ichi Lee. You can look that up. My interest with the book is not the book itself. What the book is basically about is a yoga position, and it is a yoga exercises for the brainstem, and a movement in a slow and methodic way that would cause the vibration in the brain. But, you know, that's the book and whatever. I'm not interested in that right now. What I am interested in is looking at comments and the character of people who made comments concerning this brainwave vibrations. Practical and brilliantly written, a unique lens for re-examining the impact that vibrations have on every aspect of our being. This is written by Kenneth Wesson, PhD, brain-based education consultant. What many people need to get their healing process going, no matter the injury. That's Midwest Book Review. And then finally, a simple way to restore us to the source and recover the natural flow of life. Serena Parable, PhD Associate Professor, California State University at North Ridge. So this is a yoga form, but the yoga form is based on what? A vibration. And the UFO commander called for what? A vibration. And I included this, even this yoga thing, because of what the Emerald UFO commander said. Now there's also another kind of vibration, which is an audio wave vibration. And we may connect this to the Emerald instructions as well. And what are we going to consider? We're going to consider something called the Mozart effect. Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. The brain vibrations generated from Mozart music and the effect on the brain. This is from Wikipedia. Joe? Mozart's sonata for two pianos in D major, K448, has been known to reduce the number of seizures that people with epilepsy have. The University of Illinois Medical Center did an experiment on 29 epileptic patients. After listening to the piece for up to 300 seconds, 23 of the 29 patients experienced significant decreases in epileptic form activity, even from patients in comas. They are not certain if this effect is immediate or if it requires 40 to 300 seconds to become apparent. University of Wisconsin, Department of Psychology. A number of rats were exposed to Mozart's piano sonata and were then tested in a multiple T maze. By day three, the rats exposed to the Mozart music completed the maze more rapidly and with fewer errors than the rats in the other groups. I don't know if Wolfgang Amadeus would be pleased about that, but nonetheless. One more slide on sound vibration of the Mozart effect from Wikipedia. The approach has been popularized in a book by Don Campbell and is based on an experiment published in Nature suggesting that listening to Mozart temporarily boosted students' IQ by 8 to 9 points. Another experiment that agrees with the claim was made by Bellarmine College. The Department of Psychology at Bellarmine tested the spatial reasoning of the participants in a study by having them complete pencil and paper mazes of varied complexity. Of the 22 volunteers, the average student completed 2.68 mazes in 8 minutes after listening to Mozart's music. After listening to different types of music, the average student only completed 2.2, and after being in silence, the average student completed 1.7. Okay, so what I'm trying to do is give you confidence in the credibility of the Emerald UFO Commander's statement concerning the fact that vibrations in the brain cause changes. Now, we have to, there's something very important for you to keep in mind. The effect is temporary. The word also confirms what the Emerald Commander said. He said, use it as needed. So if you get into a situation, that's darkness or health or whatever it is, do it if you want to. Note that the instructions is to use it as needed. Now, I want to show you what I feel. What are we seeing here? We've seen two situations concerning vibrations. We've seen the audio vibration, and then we also looked at the other type of vibration, which was the brainwave vibrations of yoga. So there's two types, but they're both vibrational, and we've seen from scientific studies that the musical vibration causes changes. Now, to me, the most proof. I want to turn you back to who I think is a brilliant physicist, John Cramer. Once again, this is his credentials. If you want to argue with him, have at it. He's a professor of physics at the University of Washington in Seattle. Not teaching, he works with the solenoidal tracker at RHIC detector at the new relativistic heavy ion collider at Brookhaven National Laboratory and the particle accelerator at CERN in Geneva, Switzerland. So anybody watching out there, I didn't say this stuff, he did, and if you think he's wrong, well, call him up and tell him where he's made a mistake. I wouldn't do that. His paper was titled Transactional Interpretation, and here it is. Transactional Interpretation, we've gone over this before, and it has to do with alpha waves and confirmation waves, with electrons being, photons being attracted to electrons. But let me give you the description from John Cramer's work, and I want you to connect it to the words that the Emerald UFO Commander said that the words he was giving you to repeat change you because of their vibration. This is what he says. When an electron vibrates, it attempts to radiate by producing a field which is a mixture of a retarded wave into the future and an advanced wave to the past. This energy or wave heads off into the future until it encounters an electron which can absorb the energy being carried by the field. And John Kramer concludes this particular paragraph by saying, the process of absorption involves making the electron that is doing the absorbing vibrate. Now, 30,000 years ago, before there was any quantum physics or before there was anything, somebody from this UFO fleet said, the words that I am giving you will cause a vibration. The words don't mean anything. They are not names of anybody. But according to this commander, they are magic because of the fact that they will make the changes necessary. And John Kramer did not stand alone. Now remember, he said that the absorption of the photon and the electron is caused by the vibration. NASA, National Aeronautics Space Agency, came along and they said, entirely optical computers are in the future, but electric hybrids have been possible since 78 when it was learned that photons can respond to electrons. That's from the National Aeronautics and Space Administration. Okay. You know something? How many times have you and I sat here? How many times have we thought about, okay, we said, now concentrate on, you know, making your pineal vibrate. And we all sat there.
You're vibrating.
Here's something from physicsclassroom.com to confirm the vibration and a reminder of how to do it from the Emerald Tablet. Physics Classroom. Atoms and molecules contain electrons. The electrons have a tendency to vibrate at specific frequencies, similar to a tuning fork or even a musical instrument. The electrons of atoms have a natural frequency at which they tend to vibrate. When a light wave with that same natural frequency impinges upon an atom, the electrons of that atom will be set into vibrational motion. Back to the UFO commander, the Emerald Tablet. Untanas, Quirtis, Chaital, Guyana, Huertal, Zemvita Ardell, you must understand that the names have the power to free you by their vibration. 30,000 years ago, he said that. More to come. See ya. Thank you. Bye-bye. Okay.